Raekwon.
After me working on music.
Okay.
Yeah.
Raekwon's Only Built for Cuban Links is out about this time, so we get a time frame. So what was the
Yeah.
initial discussions as far as your role and what they wanted you to do as far as the Wu-Tang Clan?
You know, they're not, it's not a whole bunch of discussions going on. It's kind of more action is doing, you know? So I would just get calls. Hey, you wanna, I need you to do this. You got a vocal for this? I'll give you Soul in the Hole as an example. And so they caught this movie soundtrack that they were gonna produce, like basically a compilation kind of situation for the documentary Soul in the Hole. And Power was like, look, Tech, write something for it. And he said, I'm telling you, if you somehow or another put the name of the movie in the title, you're gonna get it. You know what I'm saying? So like, do that. And again, I don't know anything about this part of the business at all. So I'm like, oh, okay. The movie's called Soul in the Hole. Like, what do you mean? Like, of course, Soul in the Hole is the record. And every kind of opportunity came like that. That was in 95 as well. Also in 95 would have been All That I Got Is You with Ghost. And there's some misconception about how I came to get on that record and yada, yada, yada. When the reality is, this is the true story. Mary, I want to say she was with MCA at the time. They would not allow her to release the single. Ghost knew it needed to be a single. They cleared it for the record, but would not clear it for the single and for the video. So I had to go in, recut the vocal, and appear in the video for the song. So that's how, and that was a super struggle for me because number one, I love Mary J. Are you stupid? Like, I love her. Secondly, I got my own songs that I prefer to be singing that I don't want to recut something that's like a bona fide classic. Like, I don't want to, like, but you gonna say no to Ghost, right? And he's like, I need you to do this for me. And now I'm like, second best vibes of like, holy shit, I didn't even know this was gonna happen, and you right here. Like, will you do this for me? Absolutely, I will absolutely do it. And so I did, and I tried to put my own little spin on it with the harmonies and whatever. But and that turned out to be a really beautiful thing, you know. And that was the second video only that I had ever shot with them. So you know, it there aren't very many conversations about, all right, look, we want to do this. Besides, when I got the deal, my record deal was just a solo deal, you know, which was really was great as well. And then that kind of came down to who's going to produce the record. RZA obviously is producing the record. I want beats from Fourth Disciple as well, and I wanted some joints from True Master as well. Who else did I want some joints from? I liked our nuclear family as far as where the producers were concerned, because we really did speak the same language. RZA and I have a language that we speak where our creativity is concerned, that if you ask me is unmatched. I haven't seen anybody do it before or since. It's something that is unique to what we do. I would say the same about Fourth Disciple as well. There's a little bit of mystery in how it captures my voice and the things that I prefer to talk about. You know, you might not hear one of my solo songs in the club because I'm maybe a little more intellectual and less party. I don't know.
Right.
But it works for that sound, you know, because I believe that they are communicating through the production as well. You know, the beat, if you want to call it that one, actually it's a composition. The composition is incredibly intelligent and incredibly thoughtful. So there's a message being sent through that music that I'm trying to embody as well. And we just happen to be telling some similar stories in the message that we're trying to deliver in the songs. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
So anyway, yeah.
At this time, are you still signed to the deal in Chicago, and is Razor Sharp Records in the picture at this point?
No. So at this time, I had left the company in Chicago, and this was over a couple of different things. I started noticing that I was going to be running up against some battles creatively that then I did not have the wisdom and really the development to be able to express properly. But they they had some growing that they needed to do as well, as far as just being a new company and not understanding the art and understanding, like, okay, what does this mean? There was a big conversation about, well, you got to pick one. You can't rap and sing because nobody's doing that. And it wasn't until I left the Kingsley group and had went, you know, caught up with Wu-Tang that they never had seen anything like that until Lauren dropped, you know, came with the Fuji. Then it was like, oh shit, oh no. So now that everybody says you can do it, no, right. I showed you that I can do both of these things, you know, exceptionally. Not like, ooh, bars is yikes. But Wu-Tang, they, even though they met me through those three songs, I was rhyming on those songs as well. Like, I was an MC. That's what I would do. That's what I do. That's what I was doing first. I wasn't singing first. I was rhyming first. The checks came a lot quicker singing. So that, it's just to keep it a buck. So that made it easier for me to make a living because I could get a great check for a feature to sing a hook. Like, are you stupid? Like, okay, cool. So.
Right. Mm-hmm. Ghostface happens exactly 25 years this month. Does it seem like it's been that long?
No, it seems like it's been. It seems like it's been a decade. It seems like it's been a decade. That's what it feels like to me. And then, but then I have a daughter who is 21 years old this year. She made 21 in August. And so that's like a good time, a time gauge for me. Like, it's pre-prana, post-prana. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
like, that's how I kind of understand my own timeline. And I don't know. I kind of feel like I'm age-defying a bit where I really don't view things as linear, I think, you know, like, to me, this whole experience is in the arts and with music and with Wu-Tang, and then everything that I've done outside of Wu-Tang, which I know we'll probably cover a little bit of, but it's not like just a straight line, you know. It's like, that's why it's hard for me to, like, 25 years, blood, like, huh?
Right.
What you mean?
Exactly.
Like, I was just living in Brooklyn 2 days ago. Like, what you mean? Like, is it like, holy shit.
So Prana's father is the RZA, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So anytime during this timeline, you can kind of develop at what point that relationship started.
Yeah.
So at this point, it's not a relationship.
Oh, nothing.
Okay.
And I do mean literally nothing. Like, and when I say nothing, because I'm so hyper self-focused, you know, I'm thinking about is what's in front of me. Like, that's all that I'm thinking about. And at that stage of my life, I wanted to understand the work that I was doing. I needed to understand the people that I was around. So I don't generally trust people. Again, back to the anxiety, I just don't trust people. It takes me a very long time to build trust. So in my first 4 or 5 years with them, I was playing the wall, like, what y'all doing? What y'all got going on? You know? and RZA and I always spent a lot of time together because studio, you know, and recording, but it was not a romantic kind of connection. It was very, and I wouldn't call it sibling either. I just knew that he understood me. He truly understood me, and there was no judgment, you know, in how I move, who I am. I've always been extremely different. So even like the women, like being a California girl, living in New York and seeing the difference between like the vibe of women, even that alone, I was like, holy shit, like, y'all are hella different, hella cool, but super different from me. Like, oh my, what am I gonna do? You know? So he was always just like, you want it, just stay on what you want. You know, you good, you good, you good. And so it wasn't until maybe like, gosh, the 98, might've been 98, where we started consciously talking about, well, what it would be, almost like, I hate to say it's like this, but almost like scientists. It was two scientists talking about, what would it be like to have a child? Like, like our child, what would our child be like? Let's talk about that. We don't have a physical relationship at this time. We are truly building. It's something I don't really talk about very often, but it's important to the context of even the work that Prana and I are doing now. Is really it comes from this original thought of him and I and this child that we charged ourselves to bring into the world. And she is the embodiment of everything that we projected. On top of that, for myself, I'm not gonna speak for him, but for myself, I knew as well that this will be a lifelong, lifetime friendship and family and support. We don't have to be together, not be together. There are no constraints on our friendship and our relationship. And that has been tested over and over and over again, to where now we've known each other 27, almost 28 years this year coming up. And it's tested, you know what I'm saying? It's tried. And it's one of the most rewarding friendships that I have. And as a co-parent, and you know, now with our daughter being 21 years old, and then to even hear him talk to her about, like, yeah, you know, Prana, you were conscious, like you were a consciously thought of child, like it wasn't like, oh, whoops, you know, it wasn't no whoopsie going on, you know what I'm saying? And I think that shows in how him and I interact with one another, in our consideration of her and her other siblings. Prana is one of seven. Riza has seven children. She's my only child. In consideration of his wife, I was married prior, in consideration of my former husband, like, you know, still like trying to keep it cool. But the reality is that's my family. You know what I'm saying? That's my family. Right. And we have a respect for one another, that we've been fortunate enough to use a bulk of wisdom and a shitload of understanding of how we operate with one another, you know? And then that trickles down to Prana or over to Prana.
Right.
So, yeah.
You appeared on Ghost, like I said, 25 years ago this month. It is now 1997. It's time for the guys to come together for Wu-Tang Forever. What are you witnessing amongst these guys and some of the sessions where you appeared on Three Cuts?
Wu-Tang Forever, man, you know what? Yeah, this was a deep time too. There was a lot of changes and stuff going on as well. And again, because I was late to the party, you know, they've been together their whole lives. I had just kind of showed up around 94, 95. We were doing a lot of cross country hopping. I know half of that album, or at least Second Coming, I believe I recorded in Los Angeles. I recorded that on the East Coast. But if possible, I recorded it in LA, and we had like a whole setup there. But I don't know if anybody remembers those Hollywood apartments, in Burbank, and it's like everybody named Mama stays there for like projects for films and, you know, studio shit, whatever. So we had a fleet of those and had cars shipped out from New York. Like we were in LA for quite some time working on the project, and there was, I feel like maybe I might have done like maybe a week or two's worth of work, but then we were there for like 2 months. It's like, okay, I guess this is how this goes. And again, me not knowing, me being new to this environment and how they operate is not your traditional record label vibes, which also at the time I should have been working on my solo project. I had a bunch of work ready for that, but you know, you're just doing it moving. So
right.
That's a, and actually what, I wasn't on three, was I? No, I was only on, it's only on two on Forever. Only
was
two
there
on
background? Forever. Background vocals on Heaters?
Mm-mm, I don't think so.
No? Okay. Second Coming and Impossible. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To remind...
I think people kind of give me credit for things that I'm like, nah, I didn't do that. And anything that my voice is on, my name is on. on it. Like I feature, I don't do background vocals. I hate to be like that, but that's just the reality right. of the situation.
To remind some of the fans of your contributions, I want to play a little bit of Impossible.
Oh man, Black Boy, I forgot about that one too. I ain't thought about
Capadonna,
that.
Capadonna, yeah, we're gonna get to that.
Yeah, oh snap, I just saw somebody who said that. Liberty Cradle, I see you.
I'm only doing a snippet because I think Instagram likes to flag people if you play too much.
Oh,
but take us back to that session.
Oh my God. Okay, the Impossible session. Oh geez, you really making me stretch for this one. Impossible session. Oh nope, that was at the house. That was at the Wu Mansion out in Jersey. And so I had heard the beat. RZA hadn't laid his verse yet. Ghost had his verse. And holy shit, I was like, oh, this is the one. Like, this is my song? I get to be on this one? I'm a fast worker. It don't take me, I probably cut that hook in like 20 minutes, like 15 minutes, like, it's hard to describe a session that doesn't take very long, but for me, it's the beat. Like, it's everything for me, and especially Ghost verse, after me hearing the verse and me being on some, you can never defeat the gods. It was, to me, an embodiment of how I had come to know them in that little brief time of me knowing them then. Like they are extremely powerful. So I was really saying what I meant. You know, it wasn't just trying to be like, say something cool. Like, I was like, y'all don't see these niggas, man? Like,
right.
They are giants. Like, yes, you could never defeat the gods. You know, the session was easy peasy. To me, it's more about the intention of what the song meant to me. And then the verses, all three of them verses was cold. The coldest to me of all time, like top five.
Right. What are you witnessing as far as the camaraderie of the guys? Because there's talks of, you know, it was hard getting everybody together. Are you seeing this album come together pretty easy? Or is there, you know, stalling as far as trying to get verses from everybody?
No, well here's the thing from my perspective about that. I think it would be like you trying to get 10 of your cousins to do one thing at one time and everybody has that other shit that they got going on too. To me, it didn't ever really seem like out of the realm of reality, bro. Like, we talking about 10 different men doing 10 different things with their own 10 entourages, their 10 families, there's a lot going on. To me, it would be like any kind of scheduling situation. Sure, they may have had some inner workings that I have no clue about. It's not a question for me to answer. That might have been leading to a motherfucker not wanting to come to the studio, or if there's these are brothers, dude. They argue like real brothers do. But when it's time to show up and get it done, and from my perspective, they would get to the table. If now whether that happened at the time that everybody needed it to, probably not. But right. To me, it's like how it is in any big family, you know?
Right. At this point, I'd like to jump into Second Coming.
Love that.
Take us back to the discussions, getting your own track, Second Coming.
I was so irritated because I told RZA, please don't put this on the album, please. And by myself, I was like, why? He was like, this shit crazy. This is like, this MacArthur Park, it's that vibe. Like, nah, we need this. I'm telling you, people gonna love it. And I was mortified. I have to be honest. I didn't think it properly represented some of the music that I was doing at the time that no one had heard, and probably to this day have not heard, okay? Because the album didn't get dropped. So this was tough for me. This again was a tough one, but then the way that people responded, they were like, yeah, I'm fucking with this. Second Coming is cold. And I'm like, oh, okay. So what do I know then? I guess I don't know nothing. But this was a tough one for me. But then feeling so honored and feeling like of all the things he could have done and all the songs he could have put on the record, that, you know, to have that kind of a highlight, you know, was completely unexpected. And it's almost like getting a compliment. I don't do very well with like receiving a compliment. To me, it was the same thing. Like, stop. Why are you doing this? This is crazy,
right?
But I'm really proud of it. You know, looking back now, I'm like, oh my god, you was bugging. Like, it's cool. It's a dope record.
At this point, this is without a doubt the peak of the Wu-Tang Clan. Is the Razor Sharp record deal in the mix, or is a bidding war going on for Tekitha at this point?
No. At this time. I had already did my deal. I did my deal in 95. And actually, RZA had to pay an undisclosed amount to get Cap, Ghost, and I released from Sony so that we could own the material that we had been recording while we were with them. That was going on at this time too, which I believe is what actually stalled my project. Plus, I really didn't have effective management. You know, at that time, my experience that I had with the Kinsey Group gave me a glimpse of something. But then I also knew that there were elements that were not properly operating there. Then when I was in New York and dealing with the Clan, I had management, but not really management that was really focused on, okay, let's get this done, let's do this, blah, 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 nothing like that. And because I'm an athlete, back to the athlete thing, I'm a creature of organization. You got to give it to me straight and in a timeline that is not no last minute. The thing I hate the most out of everything is somebody telling me something they need me to do last minute. I hate that. Because we all have the same hours in the day. Be thinking ahead is all, so that we can get these things, you know, lined up. None of those things would happen. And then I didn't have enough experience. I didn't know what I actually needed from management or from a label or from a company to help to support the vision that I had for myself as a solo artist. So that kind of that definitely threw a wrench in the plan, but I was still moving, you know, and shaking, and you know, I was still traveling and touring and performing, and I was there's another thing too that's different from like now to then. I didn't have a single out. I only had the couple few songs I had featured on. But I was still rocking shows, performing whole songs, and motherfuckers be up there like I don't know what she's saying, but she's spitting, and right. she's singing them hooks, you know what I'm saying? Like on my own songs too, you know what I'm saying? I was doing a lot of like rhyming the verses and singing the hooks, and then I would rhyme to like Incarcerated Scarfaces or Children's Story from Slick Rick. I would just decide with a DJ prior to the show, yeah, I'm rocking to this today. These are the beats I want today. So that at least they'd have something familiar going into their ears while I'm just blasted. So
kind of going along with